Okay, yes. I have been managing projects related to PFAS phase-out together with Joel Svedlund from Peak Innovation. And I will talk about fluorine-free skiing here today. So when we talk about fluorine in ski wax, we talk about highly fluorinated organic compounds or PFAS. These are synthetic chemicals and they do not exist naturally in nature. And they should not be confused with the fluorine elements or fluorine ions that exist in nature and which is used in toothpaste, for example. So those are two different things. So PFAS, what they are, they are usually long chains with carbon bond to fluorine. And this chemical bond is the strongest of all the chemical bonds, which makes them very difficult to break down. So a PFAS chemical usually is long chains, organic compounds with either three fluorinated or two fluorine atoms bound to carbon. There are more than 4,730 different PFAS compounds. And only a few of these compounds have been evaluated in terms of health effects. This one shown here is one of the most common ones. It's called PFOA, and this will be restricted from this summer in EU from 4th of July 2020. According to the Swedish Chemicals Agency, about 800 PFAS compounds are covered within this restriction. But it also means that there's a lot of PFAS which is not restricted, but it doesn't mean that they are not harmful. PFOA is also now listed as a persistent organic pollutant for global elimination within the UN Stockholm Convention. So it means that also countries outside EU will have this PFOA restriction. We are all exposed to PFAS. It's everywhere and all of us have PFAS in our blood. The levels are probably different. The main source or exposure risk to PFAS is from food that we eat and what we drink. We also have the PFAS is also spread through the placenta to the fetus, and PFAS can also spread through to the infants through breastfeeding. PFAS chemicals are very mobile, or some are mobile, which means that they spread easily in air and in water. So we have that exposure as well, and that's also why we can measure PFAS in the blood of ice bears or polar bears. So they are very mobile, and they are persistent. And since they are persistent, it takes very long time if they break down. So it means that the concentration is higher the longer up in the food chain you come. So if we look at skiing as an example, you also have a direct exposure risk when you wax your skis. So it's very important that safety equipment is used. And we also know that ski wax is spread in the snow, and it ends up also here while skiing. So there is a constant increase of background exposure, and ski wax is only a small piece of all the PFAS existing. There are PFAS in so many other products as well. So what are the risks? As I said before, there are only a few PFAS that are really studied in terms of health effects, but there are studies showing that with exposure to PFAS, you have a risk for quite many different effects. Decreased birth weight, cardiovascular effects, increased levels of cholesterol. You also have lower response to vaccines. And what's really scary with these chemicals is that they bind to proteins in the body. So they are sort of flowing in the blood, and they are mainly affecting organs with high blood flow. It should be noted that there are no acute toxic effects. It's more the long-term effects that are of concern, and also how it affects the next generation. In POPFREE, the project, we have worked with promotion of PFAS-free alternatives, both in ski vacs, but we have also worked with cosmetics, textiles, firefighting foam, film forming agents, so different product categories that contain PFAS. And within all these industries, a phase-out work is ongoing. Focus here is about finding alternatives, evaluating the risk of new alternatives, because we want to avoid regrettable substitution. It's a lot about finding methods for screening new alternatives, and also communication, because there are many consumers that are not aware that this is a problem, and also increase the consumer demand for PFAS-free products in general. And in the POPFREE Skedung Global Project, we have worked towards a phase-out, PFAS phase-out in competitive skiing. These projects have been financed by Vinnova. We're also now waiting for response if we can work with POPFREE Future Ski. But in the SkiVax case, we have worked with methodology for screening and benchmarking new chemistries and new SkiVaxes. This is together with industry partners and sports tech. There is methods available to screen new SkiVax. We have done tests in the lab. We have Sportex friction sled, and we have compared with the traditional glide tests, speeds and times, with promising results. We have worked with communication activities and assessment of new alternatives. In POPFREE Skedung Global, an initial an international dialogue was initiated. So we gathered key stakeholders from the ski sport, and together we drafted a roadmap towards PFAS-free competitive skiing. And what was also done within the project was that we knew already from the beginning that if there will be a restriction in the future, test methods for PFAS is needed for competitions until there are existing alternatives performing as well as the fluorinated ones in all the conditions. This is the sort of list why a global phase-out of fluorowaxes should be considered. So we have the EU restriction of PFOA, which is from summer, and we have other restrictions coming, and we also have the EU working towards eliminating all non-essential use of PFAS. And essential use meaning that it's life-saving. We have the health and environmental concerns of these type of chemicals. And we also have, which was basically starting the ban in Norway on youth competitions to promote equality in the sports. Many companies find sustainability is very important, and they don't want to sponsor something which has sort of a negative impact on the environment. And it's positive to lead the way and not just to follow. So the roadmap that we generated together with key stakeholders from the ski sport, we identified 6 different areas or topics to work with at the same time. The golden aim was basically the ban at the FIS level and IBU level. But new products are important, research to find methods, regulation to pilot methods at competitions, a lot about communication and awareness, why is this happening, and work safety is always important. But then our estimation of this ban came much earlier than we anticipated. So November 23rd, the FIS Council decided on a total fluorine ban in all skiing disciplines already from season 2020-2021. So just out of curiosity, how many here think this is a good decision? Good. This decision, I would say, turned the ski sport upside down. Yeah, as Jan said, it came a little bit like a shock. But the FIS total fluorine ban is the right way. Sooner or later, there will be a wider legal restriction of PFAS substances, and I think this will come quite sooner than expected. And it's also hard to separate different PFAS substances in screening methods. So we cannot just measure PFOA. It's either fluorine or not. But how can this ban be successfully implemented? There's a need for a robust screening method. We need proper regulatory framework, and we also need the right sanctions. And this is what we hope we can work with within POPFREE Future Ski. We identified 4 different methods to detect fluorine on skis. All of these have shown promising for the feasibility results. The ultimate one is, of course, a handheld device. So you want to quickly screen and you get a green or red light and you can compete. The skiffs one has been used in Norway on youth competitions. Then you measure on a piece and you send it for analysis. You have FTIR that measures directly on the skis. We believe that dogs are very promising to screen larger amount of skis quicker, and also ski waxing areas, for example. Other aspects that is needed to succeed is a general acceptance of the ban, and also a will for a successful implementation, and the trust and communication is important between industry and athletes and also the regulators. Restrictions have been successfully been implemented in other sports, such as swimming and Formula One, all with restriction decreasing the speed, but the sport is still going strong. This opened up a new ski wax market. Some companies have already started with fluoro-free labeling on the products, so it's easier for the consumer to choose fluorine-free. There are different fluorine-free waxes, different performance levels, different price levels, and it's also new waxes being produced for different conditions and different temperatures. Focus in the future will be also very much on structure and on ski dynamics and on ski-based materials. And with the innovation level increasing, these new solutions need extensive testing. This is just showing that some of the existing fluorine-free products out there. And what is needed is for industry to make new innovations, new fluorine-free products. Like professional ski waxers and elite teams and skiers, we need to learn how these fluorine-free waxes behave and how they perform in different weather conditions and snow conditions. So it's like a little bit like starting over, really learning more about the fluorine-free alternatives as have been done for the fluorinated ones before. And for us, everybody, it's just to enjoy skiing in a fluorine-free environment. If you live in Östersund, you can come and watch the Dark Water movie with us. It's related to the PFAS scandal in US. It's based on the documentary The Bitter Taste of Teflon. So if you want to go and see this movie, please sign up. It's free of charge. Yes.